Hello, my name is Theresa Lüth and I'm a PhD student at the University of Lübeck at the Institute of Neurogenetics. It is my pleasure to present you today how my colleagues and I have used nanopore single molecule sequencing to investigate mitochondrial DNA CpG methylation in Parkinson's disease. In the beginning, in brief, I would like to give you some general information about Parkinson's disease and mitochondrial dysfunction. PD is the fastest growing neurological disease worldwide, with more than 7 million affected patients, and characterized by the cardinal symptoms tremor, bradykinesia, and rigidity, but also non-motor symptoms can be present as well. These symptoms result from the sawdust of dopaminergic neurons in the brain. And beside other risk factors, approximately 2 to 5% of the PD cases can be explained by a monogenic cause. Like, for example, biallelic mutations in the Parkin gene, so homozygous and compound heterozygous mutations, are a well-known monogenic cause of recessively inherited early-onset Parkinson's disease. And all patients included in this study were biallelic mutation carriers affected with PD. The E3 ubiquitin ligase Parkin, which interacts with PINK1, as you can see on the figure on the right, are essential for the degradation of depolarized and thus damaged mitochondria. Mitochondria in general are key players in Parkinson's disease pathogenesis. Mitochondrial dysfunction, which includes respiratory chain, mitophagy, and mtDNA maintenance impairment, can be present in idiopathic PD as well as in monogenic forms of the disease. On the other hand, mtDNA epigenetics and its implication in Parkinson's disease remains an enigma so far, which is mainly due to contradictory reports about its level and the biological relevance of mtDNA methylation, but also due to methodological limitations. So far, only one report has shown altered methylation in the non-coding D loop of the mitochondrial genome in patients with PD. Next, I will show you how we have used whole genome nanopore sequencing of native DNA to investigate mtDNA CpG methylation. The sample size in our study was small. We included five patients affected by PD and which were also biallelic Parkin mutation carriers, and also three healthy controlled subjects. DNA extracted from whole blood, but also, except for one patient, from induced pluripotent stem cell-derived midbrain neurons were analyzed to also have a suitable cell model to investigate a neurological disease. The library was prepared following the premium whole genome amplification workflow. However, the intended first step of this protocol, which was the amplification with random primers, was skipped in order to maintain the epigenetic information, of course. Then we analyzed our data, and therefore we called the methylation using either nanopolish or megalodon to have a comparison of two software tools. Now I would like to show you a general overview of our results. So we aimed to obtain approximately 10 gigabases of base code data per sample, and with this we got 250x coverage on average of mtDNA in the blood-derived sample. And interestingly, we got with this higher coverage of the mtDNA in the neuronal-derived sample with 830x coverage of the mtDNA. Overall, we detected low-level methylation in the blood-derived samples as well as in the neuronal-derived samples, but it was within the same range with either nanopolish or megalodon. This low level of mtDNA CpG methylation was expected and in concordance with literature. Subsequently, we wanted to validate our method. In order to explore if we got sufficient sequencing depth, we took different subsets of the generated sequencing data to stepwise increase the coverage of each sample. And as you can see on the figure on the lab, after a coverage higher than 100x, on average, the detected methylation frequency stabilized. And when we took the whole amount of sequencing data, and with this, of course, we got a coverage higher than 100x of the mtDNA, we did not observe a correlation between the coverage of a CpG site and the corresponding detected methylation frequency. Therefore, we concluded that we got sufficient sequencing depth to reliably detect mtDNA CpG methylation. Then we explored the possible possibility of nuclear mitochondrial DNA contamination. So the so-called NAMs are transpositions of the mitochondrial DNA into the nuclear genome. And generally, these sequences have a size shorter than 500 base pairs. Therefore, we filtered our reads for alignment lengths to have alignment lengths to the mitochondrial reference file for at least 1 kilobase. And as you can see in the figure, after the filtering, the detected methylation frequency only changed marginally. And therefore, we concluded that NAMs contamination was probably not influencing our results. Then we evaluated the false positive rate of mtDNA CpG methylation of either nanopolish or megalodon. Therefore, we prepared two overlapping long-range PCR products which span the whole length of the mitochondrial genome. And we called the methylation from the amplicon sequencing data to get a baseline. And therefore, we calculated the false positive rate, which was described by Goldsmith et al. The false positive rate is the number of called methylated cytosines divided by the number of total called cytosine by each tool. And we subtracted this baseline false positive rate from our methylation frequency that we detected, and also we excluded this distinct peaks in methylation frequency from the amplicon data, and we excluded these corresponding CpG sites from our blood and neuronal-derived samples, and then continued with downstream analysis. Then with our corrected methylation data, we first explored variability in the two cell types that we investigated. Although the overall methylation levels were low, we observed significantly higher methylation in the blood-derived mtDNA compared to the neuronal-derived mtDNA. The difference was significant with both software tools, so either nanopolish or megalodon, and in the same direction as you can see here in the figures. The difference was more pronounced in megalodon analysis, where we found, where we observed a mean methylation frequency of 0.04 in the blood-derived mtDNA compared to 0.02 in the neuronal-derived mtDNA. Then finally, we investigated difference in patient and control-derived DNA. We observed lower methylation levels in patients with PD compared to the healthy controls. And the difference was present in the same direction with within the blood-derived samples, as you can see in the upper two panels, but also in the neuronal-derived samples, as you can see in the lower two panels, and also regardless of which software tool we used. Again, the difference was a little bit more pronounced in the megalodon analysis, where we observed an average methylation frequency of 0.03 in the Parkin PD patients, mtDNA compared to 0.05 in the control derived samples in the blood-derived DNA. And in the neuronal-derived DNA, we observed an average methylation frequency of 0.02 in the patients with PD compared to 0.03 in the control derived samples. So from previous studies, there's evidence that mtDNA methylation levels are negatively associated with the mtDNA gene expression. That's why the altered mtDNA methylation in the patients could contribute to mitochondrial dysfunctions in the patient and thereby also to PD pathogenesis. Despite our small sample size, we could observe a significant difference in PD patients versus controls, which highlights the importance to further investigate the underlying molecular mechanism and its implication in Parkinson's disease. Additionally, we expand our pipeline to also include non-CpG modification types, like, for example, hydroxycytosine methylation or adenine methylation, which could be especially relevant in the context of mitochondrial DNA modification, according to previous reports. And with this, I want to say thank you very much for your attention, and I'm looking forward to your questions and comments.